You know, so you may have already gathered about me that I love the mission and the work of local churches like this one. Because I get to see, I'm in here a lot, I get to see people like you be part of a church like this. And one of the things that churches do is help people, and Manny is one of them. And I love making connections between the work that you all do, investing in church ministries, and lives being changed forever. And, you know, Manny's a good example of this. What a wonderful testimony this is. And I still think about, like, 4 or 5 years ago when you all did something crazy. We put on an Easter egg hunt, which seems ridiculous, right? We get a moon bounce and some Easter eggs. But that's what God used your work to bring Manny and his siblings here to church. And the next day, right after the egg hunt, he's in church. And that was great. I can talk about how some of you like saw him walking on the road and gave him rides. That was work. How elders like Bobby Van Uyen and Dr. Juan invested their valuable time in him. We could talk about how he is an end result of youth ministry, who a lot of you guys trusted his gift, and the result of a lot of you working, helping him when he went through hard times. And I love thinking about this kind of thing. The fact that what God has called his church to do is to be God's hands and feet with the end result in some ways of not just giving God the glory, but changing lives. That your investment, your giving, your investment, your service, your work in the ministry of a church might have the most reverberating impacts and leave the longest legacy in eternity of anything else you might work out. And it's true, I love talking about this kind of thing because I could talk about so many different things that you as a church work to love people and glorify God. We could talk about how you serve kids, how you love on folks with special needs, how we work hard at missions, and I could talk, and maybe I should, talk about how we need to do more at mentoring young people, giving more people more opportunities to give gifts. I am passionate about this. That the work that you as a local church do is so important and worthwhile. Thank you for being a part of the work that I believe God has called us to do here. But this week is not about that, because it occurred to me that I might owe a bunch of you an apology. And it sort of just hit me hard this week because I was looking at scripture. Let me explain. So I was reading the Gospel of Mark, and there's this. Sometimes you just read verses and they just hit you in a different way. And this did that. It hit me in a different way than it ever had before. Because in Mark chapter 6, the story more or less goes, Jesus had started his ministry as an itinerant rabbi, and he was doing some really, really important work. He was teaching, he was healing, he was changing the world, no question about it. And then he goes back home to Nazareth. And that's where he was from, that's where he'd spent most of his life. And the home crowd came to listen to Jesus teach, and they're a little surprised that, you know, someone they knew was speaking so well, I guess. And Mark, when Mark tells a story, here's what he says. I'm just going to read it. This is what happens. This is how the Bible tells a story. They see Jesus. Oh, by the way, Jesus, like God, the creator, sustainer, God in the flesh. And see what they say here. They say, isn't he the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters with us? And you see what it says there? Look what they did. And they took offense at him. This has been grating at me a little bit. This verse maybe challenged me a little bit about how I think about Jesus and how I think about work. Like, if I asked you to fill out a sheet, what did Jesus do? Most of you would write things like Jesus, he taught, he healed, he suffered, he rose from the dead, and you would be accurately describing about 1/10 of his life. Do you know who Jesus was? Do you know what he did for most of his life? You ever think about that? You know how the Son of God spent the bulk of the time he had on earth? I mean, you do know, right? He was a carpenter. And you know what carpenters do? Carpentry, right? And it was a while ago, so it was probably like stonework and other kinds of construction. It wasn't just cabinet making, really. But you know what Jesus was? He was a normal blue-collar tradesman. He was a worker for most of his life, which struck people way back then as strange. And I think it might even challenge some of us a little bit. Like Jesus, I mean, he wasn't just a carpenter, right? He was a big deal. I mean, this is the Son of God sent to earth on a mission of seeking and saving the lost to bring the gospel. And do you know what he spent most of his time doing? Well, working in an obscure carpentry shop. Like he spends like most of his important life working at things that most people would look at and go, this is really not that important. And I think most people back then, and maybe even today, we would look at what Jesus did for like 20 years and go, what a waste. I get it. Like, why would Jesus spend most of his life doing things that seem unimportant to us? Why would we ask that? Well, one of two things are true. Either God made a big mistake, or maybe we don't understand how important work that might seem unimportant is to God. And I think it might be the second one. Like, have you ever asked this? Like, why was it God's plan for Jesus to spend so much time in this carpentry shop when he could be, I don't know, like, you know what Jesus can do. He could have healed more people. He could have raised more people from the dead. He could have done me a favor and written more books in the Bible, because I've got a lot of questions that there are no answers in the Bible for. But instead of that, you know what Jesus did? I mean, sure, he had like 3 years of doing some of those things. He made disciples. He taught and healed. He did miracles for like 3 years, give or take. But he spent 20 years, a lot longer, in construction. Dallas Willard says something about Jesus that might surprise most of you. This is true about Jesus. He says, and I have this in your handout, but he says, if Jesus came today like he did back then, he would carry out his mission, he says, through almost any decent occupation. Jesus might be a clerk. He might be an accountant. He might work in a hardware store. He might be a banker, a doctor, a teacher. Jesus might have been a farmer or work in a lab, or he might be a carpenter. He might clean houses or fix cars. In other words, Willard says, if Jesus were to come back today like he did last time, he might very well do exactly what you do. He might live in an apartment next to you. He might live in the house next door. He might have your exact education and life prospects and live in your family's surroundings and time, and none of that, Willard says, would be the least hindrance to the eternal kind of life that was his by nature and becomes available to us through him. Do you know who Jesus was when he was on earth? He was a carpenter for most of his life. And he was joyfully content to work day in, day after day, working with his hands, working at constructing things. Have you ever thought about that? Like, I mean, think about it. The one who was the master craftsman, like this guy made the entire world. He put the stars in place. He made trees and mountains. Do you know what he did for most of his life on earth? He made things with his hands. The one who masterfully fashioned people from the dust of the earth. He made chairs for people to sit on in their houses. Like, Jesus knew exactly what it meant to wake up and go to work every day, even when he didn't feel like it. Jesus experienced both the exhilaration and exhaustion from putting in a hard day's work. Jesus faced work, and look, his workplace was also affected by sin, just like all of ours. And you can imagine what his customers may have been like, that the complaints that he would have gotten about this or that. Or here's what I think about. Like, there's this like really riveting scene in the Last Supper, right? Where Jesus shocks everybody by ignores a social convention, and he picks up this basin and a towel, and he kneels down, and he starts washing his disciples' dirty feet, and everyone's sort of surprised, but here's the thing. This wasn't new for Jesus. Like, it's not his first time getting his hands dirty. Jesus modeled a basin and towel kind of servanthood humbly in a carpentry shop for years, doing stuff that nobody thought was important. And Jesus, I mean, his humble service in his workplace became the training ground for that display of servanthood in the upper room at the Last Supper. And folks, when we follow Jesus, we follow the example of a hardworking carpenter. I mean, who worked with his hands day in and day out in a carpentry shop. That was not somehow below the creator of the universe. Jesus didn't see his carpentry work as useless or mundane or useless. In fact, do you know what gave carpentry value to Jesus? Well, the simple fact that it was work that his Father called him to do. And when God calls you to do something, that makes it, by definition, holy, which meant that the carpentry Jesus did was just as important as anything else he did, which tells you something about Jesus. Jesus was a worker. He worked at a job that hardly anybody noticed for decades. And then he goes to worship. And I imagine talking in a gathering like this, and people, this is crazy, people looked down at Jesus. In fact, you see what it says? They were offended at Jesus. And there's good reasons to be offended by Jesus, like when you hear what he says about himself or what he says about us. But this isn't one of those like stumbling blocks sort of things. This is people going, you're not a pastor. You're not a missionary. I don't think you're approved to speak here. Were you ordained? Did you go to seminary? Like, and he wasn't, and he hadn't. And people were, you see what it says? They took offense that a carpenter would dare talk about God. Because there was this assumption that if you're called by God, you do something in a religious sector. And if you're not called by God, you get a regular job, is what they thought. And they were wrong, because they didn't understand the holiness of everyday work done before God. And that Jesus spends most of his life in construction says something about construction and work, and also says something about the holiness of every kind of job. Jesus is a worker. It also says something like, not just about Jesus, you should know that about Jesus, but also says something about people. And I think people, like, we've got this idea sometimes that churches, pastors, missionaries, they make a difference, they're holy, they're called by God, or whatever. And then we think people working normal jobs have a less holy calling. And if you think that, you're wrong. Like, there's this whole group of people in Nazareth who thought that, and if you find yourself in a group of people who are offended because a carpenter's talking, we should probably change groups here, right? We should switch groups. And here's why I need to apologize. I think there's probably been times where I am so excited about what churches do that I've undervalued the everyday normal work that God calls everyone to do. The fact is, as important as the stuff I get really excited about, what we do when we're working together as a church, as important as that is, the Bible seems to teach that what you do in being faithful to whatever work that God has called you to do, that is just as holy, just as pleasing to God as any other calling. Whatever your vocation happens to be, you have a holy calling because it is in the presence of God himself. And here's how I know this. Like, back to the story of Jesus, right? So if you go before this, if you go before Jesus enters into this itinerant ministry traveling around, this is Matthew 3. Jesus, I mean, he's still a carpenter. He's not traveling. He hasn't healed anybody. He wakes up in the morning. He does what carpenters do, carpentry. And one day in Matthew 3, he and a bunch of other people, he gets baptized and the Spirit of God descends, you know, this scene like a dove. And the voice out of like heaven declares, this guy, this hardworking carpenter, this guy who's in construction, is my beloved son, the Father says, with whom I am well pleased. I mean, it doesn't say, look, here's a guy who's been working 20 years not doing anything important. I wish he did something with his life, right? That's not what God says. He says, here is a carpenter in whom I am pleased with. He's my son. And I've been watching. The Apostle Paul, and I don't have time to trace all the texts out, but he makes this connection between Adam and Jesus. Adam was this God's first human creation. Jesus is God's son, and Paul in Hebrews makes lots of connections here. Jesus succeeds where Adam fails. He was without sin. He didn't rebel or he didn't mess up. But one of the things that doesn't change, that both the old Adam and the new Adam both reflect the image of God, the creating, sustaining God, because both Adam and Jesus are workers. We've been talking about this. Adam was created and put in the Garden of Eden to work it. We've talked about this. It says something about people, that we were created, we were designed to reflect the image of God by creating, by maintaining. And what we've been saying is that your vocation, whatever it is a holy calling because God's called you. And then we read about in Genesis how sin makes work what it is today. It's messed up. It's often tainted by sin and selfishness, and part of the grand arc of God's redemption is that following Jesus right now means discovering how to redeem work and work the way we were designed to be fully fulfilled human. Or take this verse. Jesus, this is way back in Matthew, Jesus makes this invitation to people like us to follow him and learn how to live. This is what Jesus says in Matthew 11. He says, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Then he says something that I wouldn't expect. He says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You ever notice kind of a twist in this verse? Here's the thing about this. In this great invitation to rest, like how do you rest? It all starts with a yoke, which sounds fine unless you know what a yoke is. It's not part of an egg. A yoke is a working term, right? It's like Jesus comes and says, come to me, are you weary and burdened, and I'm going to give you rest. Here, you know what it is, right? This is like manual labor. This is a job. I don't know that much about oxen, but I think if you're an ox and you pull stuff and that's your job, like the yoke is that thing that gets strapped to you, right? Am I right? And you have to pull it and you, I don't know, work at it? I don't know if I like this. I would want to hear Jesus say something like, come to me, I will give you rest. Here's a lazy boy, here's a drink, sit back and relax. That's not what Jesus says. Come to me if you're weary and burdened, I'm going to give you rest. Oh, let me strap you in here. You've got some work to do. Here's a job. Maybe it's a career, maybe it's taking care of kids, maybe it's chores. Some of you are retired folks who work more now than you ever did before. But here's the point. For Christians, you come to Jesus, you're following him with your burdens and your weariness, and God gives you a job. You're working at something, which says something about you. It says that your vocation is a calling. And you could hear Jesus calling you, working with Jesus, yoked with Jesus, like a team. It's an invitation to work differently, the way God intended you to live, starting all back in the Garden of Eden, a way to live before sin and selfishness entered the world. You know, this word rest, this invitation to a life that God invites us to live, is only made possible because of the gospel. and is found by working connected to Jesus. In Jesus' yoke, we learn how to work a new creation life, worshiping, submitting, and obeying God's word. In fact, this is what it means to follow Jesus, to be yoked to him. Like, you're still working, but you're working with God here. It is figuring out how to be faithful to God in your vocation, whatever that happens to look like. And I think brilliantly, Jesus teaches not just how to live. Like, he doesn't just teach you how to live on your off time, but he teaches you how to work. And following Jesus means working hard, but in a healthy way, where sin and selfishness has been dealt with, because you're working for God, not for people. Here's how Paul says it somewhere else. This is Colossians 3. Whatever you do, like whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for people, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. And see the next line? Like, remember, you know what he's talking about, right? Whatever you do, like whatever you do, you are serving the Lord Christ. That means whatever you do, carpentry, technology, parenting, like whatever your job is, you are serving the Lord. And here's how God designed us, that your ordinary day-to-day work life is designed by God to be extraordinary. And do you know what makes work holy? It's not what you do, really. It's who you're doing it for. And your work becomes holy when whatever it is, you're doing it for the Lord Jesus, which is huge. This means that when you go to work day in and day out, look, here's the facts. You might feel like your life is full of ordinary, meaningless days. The fact is, those ordinary tasks done before God, that's what makes it extraordinary. And here's a pivot. This was, by the way, a major theme of the Protestant Reformation, right? The sanctity of work. Tom Nelson, and you're hearing a lot from him, he tells a story of a friend of his who studied this a lot. And this is a guy who spent a lot of time looking at his work. He happened to be a CEO of a big company. And Tom Nelson tells a story and says, previously, this CEO understood, he thought that his main job as a Christian CEO was to kind of just make a lot of money and then give some of that money to good causes, and the good causes make a difference. He was super generous, gave lots of money to missionaries and charities and causes. And the way he saw it, like, you know, this is a holy thing over here. This is a not holy work over here. So I may work my not holy thing really hard and then give a lot of money to other things. And he still is generous and he still supports things. He tithes and does all that. But he tells this remarkable story that he, for the first time in his whole life, started seeing his work as being more than a means to an end. He started to see that, you know, whatever you do is you are serving the Lord Jesus. So he started seeing, like, what I'm doing right here, Christians do everything in all circumstances. This is 1 Thessalonians 5. Paul says, look at this, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. And I'm suggesting that always, without ceasing, all circumstances include your workplace. Imagine if, you know, if those attitudes right there could expand out of church into the rest of your life. That is, well, simply put, that is the will of Christ. And the fact is, work and workplaces have been messed up by sin for a long time. They're frustrating. There's disappointments. You've probably got to deal with disappointing and frustrating, demanding people. And that's what God's called us to do. But here's what changes things. When you're yoked with Jesus, you're empowered by the Holy Spirit to positively influence a workplace culture that can better promote God's will. Sometimes it looks like the common good, and this is almost a side benefit. Like, you're doing things to God's glory, but the fact is people are watching you, even if it's just kids at home. But it's not just people watching. You are doing everything for God himself. Like the verse we read right before this, whatever you do, like every time you work, you have the opportunity to be serving God no matter what you're doing. Which means, like, that should affect how we work, right? Christians should do excellent work. We should do jobs that are well done. And I think if we think about that, then living and working before God should affect us in the good times and the bad. And, man, I love Proverbs 16:3. It says, commit your work to God and your plans will be established. I love that. Here's what's so liberating and freeing about following Jesus. This is where, like, professing faith, believing the gospel, that where you talk about thinking that your identity and future is linked to the price that Jesus paid to save you. This is where what you profess changes how you work. When you live before God, you have nothing to be afraid of. You've got nothing to hide and nothing to prove, which means you could use your energy to glorify God by doing good work. Committing your work to the Lord means that your work is always important, even if you're not getting a lot of credit for it. It also means you have the opportunity to practice the presence of God and to be speaking to him as an overflow of your walk with Christ, and you have the opportunity to bring a positive, joyful, rejoicing outlook to your work, no matter what that looks like. Here's what I'm learning. All of work, every vocation, is holy work. And even if it doesn't feel like it matters to anyone else, it matters to God. And if people don't thank you for it or respect you for it, or even if people are offended by your work, you're in good company with a carpenter. There's no ordinary work. The work that God has called you to do is extraordinary because it is serving an extraordinary God. Don't miss out by taking an ordinary approach to it. So, Father in heaven, thank you for calling us. Thank you for sustaining us, for gifting us. Thank you for the gift of your Son who calls us to himself, who saves us. May we live to his glory. Can you help us to take our faith with us from Sunday into the rest of our week, to know that you are always watching, you are always concerned. We live every moment in the presence of the Almighty. May we live, may we act, may our attitudes reflect the day when we stand before you. Do you hear the words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." I ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen.